ears essentially a...
Good evening. Welcome to Network X. I'm your host, Bill Brignoli. The area south of downtown Seattle has seen unprecedented growth in the last 5 years. A new stadium for the Mariners baseball team, a massive office complex in development by billionaire Paul Allen, and now another stadium for the Seattle Seahawks, all have been encroaching pretty heavily on one of Seattle's oldest historical and cultural landmarks, the Seattle International District. To add insult to injury, what we now have is an influx of multinational corporations trying to set up shop in there, taking advantage of the increased traffic. Leading the charge is McDonald's. So tonight, Network X is pleased to have with us in the studios three activists who have been working on this issue to oppose the entrance of McDonald's and other transnational corporations to the International District. Please join us in welcoming to the studio tonight Melissa Lynn. Melissa, thanks for joining us tonight. Melissa is a board member of the Organization of Chinese Americans. And to Melissa's left, we have Paul Kim. Welcome, Paul.
Thanks.
Paul is a Lindbergh High School student. And to Paul's left, we have Frank Irigon, who is a longtime community activist and interim board member for the Interim Community Development Association.
Thanks, Bill.
Thanks for joining us here. And if we could, Melissa, let me start with you. When did McDonald's first announce its intentions to set up shop in the International District?
Well, they never actually announced any intentions, but we did start hearing rumors around the end of last year and the beginning of this year. And those of us that were concerned about this development in the community eventually verified that sometime in January by talking to the property owner.
Now, where did the opposition to McDonald's entrance to the International District first arise from?
I first heard wind from the International District Community Development Association, from staff that are working there. Mm-hmm. And then it just suddenly started to just snowball.
Mm-hmm. It went from there to activists, and then they would come and do certain workshops for our youth groups, and then it went from there to the community. And the elderly of the Chinatown, the International District, they support us now too, mm-hmm. in the fight.
Well, how did opposition become so broad so quickly?
I think one thing to point out is, as Frankie is representative of here, there's a long history of activism in the International District and in the Asian Pacific American community. The Asian Pacific American community has always had to fight to preserve itself. And so people like Frankie have been around long enough to remember fighting the Kingdom and I-5 being built, and you know, things leading up to the developments that you mentioned at the top of this show, you know, the new stadiums and the office buildings. So the broad support that we have for this effort that's focused on McDonald's really comes from the broad support that we have in the community, just on preserving the community itself. And that's something that's been around for a long time. It's not just something that came out of a vacuum.
Mm-hmm. It was there since the early 70s. When we first formed the Concerned Asians for the International District in opposition to the building of the King Dome, where it was, you know, presently sited, mm-hmm. no longer there. But that's how it began. So as Melissa was pointing out, there is support there already. There is a commitment from many people and from many ages. One thing that people tend to forget, sometimes the International District didn't get the publicity that it so justly deserved, was that there is an activism there, mm-hmm. you know, from people.
Mm-hmm. Well,
in fact, I'm getting a call right now.
Well, actually, I was pretty amazed. I've got in the information packet I had to review before the show here, I've got a list in front of me of groups, organizations, individuals that have already publicly opposed the McDonald's, and it's quite lengthy. It looks like there's about 15 groups on here. Everything is wide-ranging from the Asian Pacific American Labor Alliance to the Wilderness Inner City and Leadership Development to Northwest Labor Employment Law Office, even the Office of the Mayor. What brings together such a diverse group?
There's a third world coalition, Bill, in the city of Seattle. When one community is being besieged, others come to its defense. And this is one thing that we found out throughout the history of the International District. The International District, when we confronted the opening day ceremonies, the groundbreaking, we had support from African Americans and from the Chicanos and from Native Americans. It's always been that way. Mm-hmm. We never had to struggle alone. We always had broad community support from very diverse peoples.
Mm-hmm. Now, Paul, I find it rather surprising too that we have in your case a young fellow, someone, mm-hmm. a high school student, who is concerned about this for the effect that it's going to have on older people.
Yeah.
Talk to me a little bit about the involvement in youth and the draw that youth has in their concern over elderly.
The media portrays the issue of being McDonald's being an ID as an adult issue, not youth, or and also an Asian issue, but it's not. We have there's so many people, such as people from El Centro de la Raza and YUIR, Youth Undoing Institutionalized Racism, Seattle Young People's Projects and project, and there's all these people across the city that's there to help us, and it's just not seen. Mm-hmm.
In
the public.
Yeah, youth has always been involved in the International District. There was an International District Youth Council. They were very supportive of our efforts in maintaining the cultural and the historical identity of the International District. Mm-hmm. And so Paul is one of many, and we're very fortunate that youth like Paul are still involved with our community, still willing to put themselves up front in order to preserve and to help the elderly and the other low-income people living in the district.
So you basically got a transgenerational effort going here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's actually one of the unique qualities about the International District that we're trying to preserve, is that the whole myth about youth being apathetic and out of touch with, you know, and elderly mm-hmm. being out of touch with the youth is just, mm-hmm. it's just not true in our community. You know, there's a lot of intergenerational work that goes on, and that's one of the strengths of this movement, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk a little bit about some of the concerns that yourselves and the organizations you represent have put forward. I mean, some people would say, well, you know, what's the big deal? I mean, what's wrong with the McDonald's? You know, hey, you got fast food, you got cheap food, you know, it's like they usually have a place for kids to play. What concerned you and your organizations the most about McDonald's moving into the area?
Well, the Golden Arches is incompatible with the historical and cultural legacy of the International District. We've had that concern way back in the early 70s when we were first confronted with the Kingdom. There was an effort to condemn buildings in the International District as being fire hazards. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the owners would not be responsible for relocating the residents, particularly the elderly, living there.
Now, this was something the city tried to do, the mayor or the city council, or?
Developers. Uh-huh. And we felt that with this displacement, it was not acceptable. And we also were concerned that with the destruction of the buildings that they would put in its place, mm-hmm. Like McDonald's or other fast food outlets. And that's why, with the Asian Family Fair, one of our first community newspapers in the Seattle area, that we had a cartoon. It showed a humbug kicking a hot dog, and basically that was it, that humbugs, not hot dogs, in the Seattle International District. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, our opposition to any fast food outlet, any multinational, goes way back, so it's not just a McDonald's thing.
Mm-hmm. And I know a couple of the points of concern that people raised was increased crime. Another one was rising rents. Have both of those impacts already been felt from the scale of the development that's slowly but surely encroaching further and further into the International District?
You know, anecdotally, we know that to be true. There's high drug use up in the park near the Nippon Khan Theater. You know, I don't know how many times they've asked the police to have a strong presence there. We see it in some of the hotels. Mm-hmm. But, we don't see the International District getting the respect that the Pike Place Market or even the Pioneer Square gets. We do not get the police presence that we justly deserve.
Even now, with the increased traffic that's coming into that area from the development of the stadium and Paul Allen?
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the things about the public safety issues, which is one of the reasons why we're opposed to McDonald's, one of the issues around public safety is because the amount of police protection that you get in a neighborhood is based on the number of 911 calls that the police department receives. And because the majority of the residents in the International District are elderly, limited English-speaking immigrants, they're not very comfortable calling up 911. Mm. Even though 911 does have translators, they don't always know that. Or even if they do know that, they may not, have a very trusting relationship with the police for various reasons. And so it's kind of a vicious cycle where, there are fewer 911 calls because of the language barriers, and then because of fewer 911 calls, there's less police protection and so forth. But I also want to point out, the public safety issue is only one of the many reasons why we're opposed to McDonald's. You also mentioned the rising rents is another reason. And we recognize that McDonald's by itself is not the whole problem, but it's very, because it's a recognizable name and it's a large multinational corporation, value-wise, it represents a lot of the things that we feel we're up against in the neighborhood. In terms of, they're really there to make a profit. They're not there to preserve affordable housing. They're not there. They say they're there for the community, but they're not. We don't really feel that they're there for us. In fact, they've as admitted that they're really there because they want the stadium traffic. They want the business from the stadium traffic and the new office buildings. So,
and just to add on to that, there's been a lot more gang activity around that area, and there's also in the downtown 3rd and Pike area where the other McDonald's is. There's a lot of gang activity there, and same as in Chinatown. And there's increased drug dealing and prostitution. And if McDonald's is put there, it'll give them a place to hang out or just to hang around, because McDonald's is open pretty late.
So that's the draw. It's a place to loiter, and it's a place that is open pretty late.
And there's very small, there's a very small amount of police protection, because at nighttime, the International District and the Duwamish and Pioneer Square shares a patrol car.
One patrol car.
I think it's more than one, but it's very small.
Interesting. A quote, I wanted to read a quote here from an article in the International Examiner by Chung Soo Khan. There's an opinion piece titled, "It's Not About the Food." He writes, "The entrance of a McDonald's signals only the beginning of a haphazard influx of multinational corporations that will effectively drain the community of valuable resources, hurt local businesses that directly benefit new immigrant groups." Do you agree with that, and could you elaborate on that?
I agree with that. I believe we all do, in terms of draining resources. The buildings that are there, apartments, hotels we'd like to see turn into affordable housing, mixed housing use for families, for workers in the area. What else, Melissa?
One thing to point out is, I definitely agree with that. McDonald's is a very powerful symbol of the overall trends that have been taking place in terms of draining resources away from small businesses and from affordable housing. Because of the new stadiums and the new office buildings. Rents have mm-hmm. already been rising. Property values have already been rising.
Have they been significant increases?
One of the reasons why the property owner at Fifth and Jackson has been looking at McDonald's is because their McDonald's can afford to pay the high rent that he's asking for, whereas small businesses cannot.
Does anyone know exactly how much they're expecting McDonald's to pay for that place?
I don't know.
I think he was asking for $30 per square foot. That was what I heard. Uh-huh. So, yeah, you'd have to verify that. But definitely, I mean, our concern about the draining of resources isn't, it's not a simple question, but definitely, as we mentioned before, there are a lot of limited English-speaking elderly Asian immigrants who are living in the International District because the services and the shops that they patronize are there that speak their language. Mm-hmm. And if they're forced to move out because the rents are raised or, you know, because there's no more affordable housing there, then they're going to have to commute a long way to find the shops or the services that they need. And it'll just make their life that much more difficult.
And McDonald's, it doesn't culturally or historically represent the International District. I mean, and the place where it's going to be located, or where they wanted it to be located, was one of the one of two main entrances into the International District. One up on north of Jackson, and mm-hmm. then one on Fifth. And then if it was there, it would just attract more people to come in. There's already a lot of traffic there with mm-hmm. no parking, and mm-hmm. It would just make it a bigger hassle, and it'll make a big opportunity for other big food chains or other businesses to move in and destroy our culture.
And this is not a building that has assigned parking.
No.
If I remember that corner,
yeah,
there is none. Yeah. So basically it would fall upon the entire International District to absorb whatever automobile traffic comes in.
Which is, we're already suffering from the impacts of the stadiums that way, because every time there's a game now at Safeco Field or, at what used to be the Kingdome, people come into the International District to park their cars and, you know, go to the game, and they don't stop and patronize the businesses. They don't work in the International District, so mm-hmm. we're already suffering from the impacts of those developments. And it's true, McDonald's would probably benefit more if they had a place with its own parking.
Mm-hmm. Sure, you need a drive-up window, right?
Yeah, apparently the McDonald's that recently closed in the University District claimed that they had closed down because they had no drive-in window. Mm. Well, at the property that they're talking about moving into in the ID, there's no room for a drive-in window, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Still, 40% of their sales goes through drive-thru. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, already they're feeling the impact if they were at the building. It's not economically feasible.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would take the time to quote from the letter from the office of the mayor, but you folks seem to have stated quite clearly just about everything that he stated, so I won't even bother.
You can still read it.
Okay.
It's the mayor.
Let us. Okay. We have it here, and it says, this is in the last paragraph, "It is highly questionable whether McDonald's would be an appropriate use in the district because it would not contribute to the Asian cultural and retail core. Neither is it clear how McDonald's would protect, preserve, or promote small retail and commercial businesses such as those that currently lease the space in the Beauty Building." Now, that's in line with an ordinance that was established by a review board, which I think, Frank, you were telling me before the show, which was something that was created to mitigate the impact of the Kingdome development?
Right. It was patterned out through the Pioneer Square PDA. Uh-huh. You're right. Mm-hmm. That's the reason for it.
So now we find it being put to use on your behalf here, hopefully
right.
quite effectively.
Right.
And actually, I should mention, I don't know if you found out about it, but I caught a news report before coming here, and it did say that McDonald's was dropping consideration for the Fifth and Jackson location due to business reasons. Have you been informed by McDonald's, or have you heard anything about it?
We haven't heard directly from McDonald's. We've heard it through other people, but until we hear it officially, it's not to be believed.
Yeah, that would be great news for us if they actually had made that decision, but until we hear it from them directly, you know, we're not going to stop our opposition. We're going to keep going. Another thing to point out is, according to what you said, it sounds like they may have made a decision not to move into the Fifth and Jackson property, but we're opposed to McDonald's anywhere in the International District. So if they're going to continue to try to move in, even at another location, we will continue to oppose them.
Well, let's talk about action. You folks had a rally today. Why don't you talk to our viewers about that rally, where it was and what it consisted of?
The rally today was at the downtown location of McDonald's, and the turnout was about 50, 75, about 100 people, and it went pretty well. There was a banner dropped from the Bon Marché parking lot, and it was pretty big, and everybody got to see that, and there was demonstrators with pickets, and we had our little saying going on, and there was a huge turnout, and a lot of people from other communities came by too, supporting our fight.
What did the banner read? Just out of curiosity.
It said, "Preserve the ID." No McDs in the ID. Uh-huh. You know, just something really. We wanted to basically represent our position very simply, so that passersby uh-huh. could see why we were there. And I think it was successful because I noticed a lot of people driving by honked at us in support. And I know before the rally, we got, we heard a lot from people about, people that not everyone that supports our position could attend the rally. So considering that a lot of the people that support us couldn't make it to the rally, we had a pretty good turnout.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, fantastic turnout, well organized. And again, concern at the beginning how many people, but there was a lot of people. As Paul pointed out, we had about 100. Mm-hmm. We had good press coverage, which is necessary when we want to highlight the issue that's affecting the international district. Very well attended. We had people on the sidelines who were listening and then joined us in our picket and marched mm-hmm. around. We also had elderly people from the international district who came with us and with their signs. So it was very intergenerational. It was a very diverse group of people.
So people responded pretty well to your
very
flyers
positive.
And your handouts? And
Hmm. Very positively.
Hmm. Well, okay, let's play devil's advocate here. Let's say they're going to try an end run, and let's say they say, okay, we're going to abandon 5th and Jackson, we're going to abandon the ID, and then suddenly they try and come in somewhere else. What are your future strategies going to be here to keep McDonald's out of the International District?
Well, we're going to continue to organize as we have been, and to try to get the word out to more people. About what the issues are and just try to expand on our current base of support. Another thing I want to point out, though, is we've already stated explicitly to McDonald's that we are opposed to them moving in anywhere else in the ID. Mm-hmm. So they know. We've already warned them face to face. We had a meeting with some representatives of McDonald's Corporation on May 16th and expressed to them that we are opposed to them moving in at the 5th and Jackson location and anywhere in the boundaries of the International District, and we will oppose them by any means necessary.
And what was their response at that meeting?
They said, "Oh, that's very interesting, and we'll get back to you," basically, mm-hmm. And I think they're weighing it from a business perspective, which is to be expected of them, to see whether or not they can prevail over us. And so I think the more we can show them that we have a really broad base of support, which I think we've at least started to show with the mayor's letter. I mean, we have the mayor's office, and we have a lot of people both within and outside of the International District supporting us. The more we can show them how broad our base of support is, maybe the more they'll realize what they're really up against. I don't think they realize just how strong our support is. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, Frank, you've been working on issues like this for a long time, and you bring a sense of history to this. Do you see parallels in some of the earlier struggles you fought to preserve the International District in this one?
Yeah, very much so. For whatever reason, there's a disrespect for the API. They think of us as model minorities.
The API?
Asian Pacific Islander people. They think of us as model minorities. They don't believe that we're willing to fight for what we believe in. And this is where McDonald's is coming from. They are emboldened by the fact that they that they built a store in Leavenworth, Washington, and over people's opposition there, they did one on Mercer Island. They just don't realize that with the Asian and Pacific Islander community, they're very strongly attached to the International District. And as Melissa pointed out, by any means necessary, we will oppose them. And that's just not plain rhetoric. If they were to look at the history of the International District, they would know that to be true.
Hmm. Well, if you folks are as successful, you'll actually be doing something that Mercer Islanders haven't been able to do. And that's pretty unique, because usually what they don't want on Mercer Island, they don't get.
Right.
So that would be one up for you folks. Well, how about now, let's assume there are some of our viewers that are going to be concerned about this as you are and are going to want to get involved and give you support. How might they do this?
Well, through the ICDA, International District Community Development Association, that's the phone number. It's 624-1802, area code 206. Mm-hmm. They can help us fight and continue our struggle. Mm-hmm.
Did you say that's 624-1802?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And how might they get involved? How could they help?
They can help us by signing petitions. They can get their friends to sign petitions. If people are interested in helping us get petitions signed, we'll mail them out to them. In fact, a lot of people have done so already, and we'll continue to do that. They can help us by, you know, educating other communities, writing letters to McDonald's, and also, you know, in the future, as further actions take place, we'll be sure to get the word out about that, and if people could join us in those actions and help us with the outreach on those actions. Mm-hmm. That would be great.
But you're not celebrating victory just yet.
No, not quite. I mean, history has taught us that, right. You know, you can never really rest. There's always, I'm sure, even if we were so lucky as to succeed against McDonald's, which is this huge multinational corporation, I mean, it would be a great victory, but I'm sure it won't be the end of the struggle to preserve the neighborhood. So it'll be ongoing. This is just one step.
Mm-hmm. Well, if the 30 or so thousand people that came into Seattle to shut down the first day of the World Trade Organization Ministerial Conference here were successful in doing that, perhaps you folks will continue to be just as successful. So we wish you the best, and what we would also like you to do is keep us posted. And if and when you do a victory, or if and when you come into another challenge, you let us know, and perhaps you'd be able to come back on the air here and talk to us again.
Yeah, thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. And thank you for joining us this evening on Network X, folks. And let me ask you to tune in next Thursday, same time, 7 o'clock, for more provocative programming on issues that affect you and your community. And on Saturday and Sunday mornings from 6 to 9 a.m., tune in to KCMU Radio 90.3 FM to listen to Mind Over Matters, the provocative public affairs programming. And let me send you out here with the usual marching orders. Stay informed and get involved. For Network X, I'm your host, Bill Brignoli. Have a good night.
America is essentially